In this edition of In the Trenches with Dave Lapham, brought to you by First Star Logistics, as always in our phenomenal studios, we catch up with Phil Sims. And we talk about Super Bowl 58. Of course, Phil was part of CBS's coverage of the Super Bowl and did a phenomenal job at many levels, as he always does. We talk about the Super Bowl, and we also talk about the quarterback play in the Super Bowl. And nobody does it better than Phil Sims. This guy knows his football. Great player and incredible broadcast talent. What did you make an outstanding decision today to join us in the trenches with Dave Lapham, brought to you by First Star Logistics, as always coming to you from our studios that we so greatly appreciate, because we have an unbelievably special guest, and that is none other than the great Phil.
Okay. Here we go.
Not just Hall of Fame caliber player. I'm talking broadcaster. I'm talking human being. Every category there is, Phil Sims is great. You are the man.
You know what it is, Dave? You just don't know me well enough. Otherwise, you wouldn't say all that. You know, so I'm looking at here, the screen I'm on, In the Trenches. And, yes, you know, I'm going to have your autograph analyzed and see what it says. I like this. It's interesting. It's very neat, and I can read it, which tells me something good. But you ever had your autograph analyzed?
I haven't. I haven't had my
hand. Don't do it. It's frightening.
Is that right?
Yeah, it was frightening. Somebody did it to me once. I said, oh, I think that is me. Like reading your horoscope, but oh well.
There you go.
Good to talk to you, man. It's good.
Great to talk to you. Great to see you. And I'll tell you what, you were outstanding. CBS's coverage of the Super Bowl was phenomenal, and you were outstanding, Phil. And tell us, now that you've had time to reflect on what you saw, What are some of the things you take from that Super Bowl that we just witnessed, Super Bowl 58?
Well, you know, we were challenged doing the show, for real, just because of lack of technology and certain things. And I hate to say it this way, but when you do the pregame show and you're doing all this stuff, and then watching the game is really hard to even – so you don't have the feel that you have, like, during the season or some the other playoff games, because it's a standalone one, but – you know, technology, everything in the stadium, space, you name it, it's all a problem. So that, you know, I'm still not happy about it. Just that some of the things I thought before the game, this was my first thought, getting ready for the Super Bowl. I had 2 weeks, so by the time 3 days are over, you're bored with one game because you've already got so much information. But right. I thought this, if San Francisco's defense wasn't aggressive, that Patrick Mahomes would tear them up. And the three times I thought they got way too conservative, the end of the first half, the end of regulation, and in overtime, you gave up. You gave Patrick Mahomes absolute knockdown, 100% completions, because you dropped back. You didn't want to give up the big play. And, of course, we've seen it. Mahomes has been very good at delegating over the last five games and throwing it short and whatever. And, you know, as a quarterback, even as an offensive lineman, you get to do a couple drops, and you know the quarterback's getting rid of the football in about 2 seconds, and you got a feel for what's going on. You're in rhythm. The defense tires out or whatever. And that would be my first drawback for the 49ers just that way. They did blitz some, but their blitzes, you know, I'm not picking on Steve Wilks or anything like that, but they were automatic. In other words, they lined up, and you just go 100% blitz.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was easy for Mahomes in that respect, and easy for me to say, but that was my first big thought about the game, and it kind of played out.
So you got that pre-snap read, like, boom, you're like, oh, here he comes.
Oh, it was automatic. The pre-snap reads were automatic, and if it was man-to-man, I will say this, too. We talk about Patrick Mahomes. It's great. He is a great player, one of the greatest ever. But Andy Reid and Matt Nagy, listen, it's like when they were blitzing, I didn't see checks much, maybe one or two times, but they had the man-to-man beaters up there. Yep. And it's timing, whatever you want to say, but they had a great feel for what San Francisco was doing. And hey, still, I know I'm all over the place. San Francisco had 15 chances to win the game and they didn't.
Yep.
And so we got what the finish is. That's all what everybody cares about.
My first reaction was, you know, watching in the trenches, how the hell do you not have four hands and multiple eyeballs on Chris Jones? How do you blow it where Chris Jones is unblocked? I mean, it's unbelievable. Not just singling him up, but leaving him unblocked because of assignment mistakes or whatever. I can't fathom that you've got one of the best, if not the best defensive player in all of football, and you're letting that guy run to the quarterback unblocked. I mean, more than once, it's like, man, what was going on there? And I guess, you know, Steve Spagnuolo did a good job of confusing the blocking patterns that the 49ers were doing. But, I mean, singling him up, you're rolling the dice. But to let him just run at the quarterback like that, I was like, oh, my gosh, man, that just can't happen in a game like that. It was crazy.
Yeah, well, the one play you're talking about was down, I think, on the 4 or 5 yard line somewhere in there. And both receivers were wide open for a touchdown. I mean, like, drop kick it, throw it left-handed, touchdowns for the San Francisco 49ers. The pass protection was blown by the right guard. He was the backup. And I think it was him that said it. He woke up and he sees his phone on Monday morning. He goes, oh, my God, everybody's getting on me. And but I mean, it's not funny, but that's all it was. If they don't blow that assignment, I'm telling you, both wide receivers, you probably saw it on replays and all that. They not only are they open, they're wide open, can't miss throws. So there's the Super Bowl for you. Every year we see things in the Super Bowl. Chicago Bears playing Indianapolis Colts. Chicago Bears, when they were in the Super Bowl down in Miami, they played cover 2 99% of the time on defense.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden they're playing cover 2 and one of the safeties decides to go way up and be like, play the line of scrimmage, and they blow the coverage. How can you do that when that's all you basically do? And what does Peyton do? He sees it and lobs one out there for, you know, a long touchdown. It was a big difference in the game. So it's crazy.
So you have Mahomes throwing the football for 333 yards, but then he rushes. He's the leading rusher, 66 yards for the Kansas City Chiefs. I mean, 399 yards offense. The fact that he was hurting them with his feet and his throwing arm like he did. I mean, how good a Super Bowl did this quarterback play?
It was really good when it counted. Overall, I mean, think about the game. I'm just off the top of my head. I was thinking about it a few minutes ago. I think he threw basically 3 passes down the field in the whole game. It was all underneath. I thought both quarterbacks were very conservative early in the game, and I understand it. Now, in this day and age, the way we just analyze the quarterbacks to death, you can't help but be very conservative early just because that mistake – can maybe ruin the rhythm of the team, but also can get in your head, Dave. For the Super Bowl, more than any other game now, it's crazy. Just think how much we analyze it during the year. What are we going to say in the Super Bowl if you make a mistake early in the game? Right. So, but Mahomes, the difference is his running in the game when it really counted. He did that. And, of course, the other one was the play calling. I thought their play calling as the game went along really was on top of everything. And a good example is that touchdown drive, the McCole Hardman touchdown, going across, stopping, coming back. Well, they didn't make the adjustment on defense. Really, that's a pretty easy adjustment. But I'm sure the moment, the nerves and all that, nobody covered him, and he was in there for the touchdown. So it was really good by Mahomes, but it wasn't great. But it was great because of the situation. You know, it's overtime. We got to get a touchdown to win it, all that. And honestly, they did it pretty easily.
That sums it up in my estimation, in a nutshell, right there, what you're just saying, Phil, because in my mind, the Super Bowl was like 3 quarters.
Yeah.
Fourth quarter and overtime, it had my attention now. Fourth quarter and overtime, some stuff was going down. And, you know,
let me say this, Dave, and you tell me, you follow it all and just – think about when they got embarrassed by the Raiders on Christmas Day, I think it was.
Yep.
I mean, they got embarrassed in every way you could possibly do it. Mahomes had maybe the worst game of his career. But what happened after it? Andy Reid said it many times, and I talk about it every single week after that. They changed. They started Mahomes stood in the pocket, made quicker decisions, wasn't moving, you know, on every play looking for the big play. And the offense, hey, they were more patient, ran the ball. And the biggest thing is so many things to talk about, but maybe the biggest thing is their defense put them in position and made it viable for them to play a certain way because of how they were playing. And those last, you know, the biggest game of all, how about that game in Baltimore? That was a knockdown, drag out fist fight.
Yeah, it was.
Kansas City was determined to show them we can play this way too.
No doubt.
Yeah. So that was, it's a, you know, Kansas City, what a, on the run, on the fly, whatever you want to say it, they make the adjustment. You and I talked about it, I think, against the Bengals.
Yep.
That was when it started, and they followed it all the way through the playoffs.
Yeah. That, I mean, to go on the road and do what they did, you know, having to be the road team was pretty impressive because Patrick Mahomes had the luxury of always playing at home, but he turned that warm. The thing that shocked me though, Phil, is the overtime, the players, right. The 49er players not having any clue about the overtime rule. Now I can understand the Chiefs were involved in a game where they changed the rule, you know, against the Buffalo Bills because they score and the Bills never get the football. And it's like, oh, we got to change this. So they're acutely aware of what's going on. And Andy Reid probably reviewed it very often with his team, but to not have reviewed it at all with the players. I mean, to have a use check Harvard, you know, it's like, we didn't know that if we scored a touchdown, we thought the game was over. I was like stunned to hear guys say that in the interviews after the game. It was shocking to me.
Yeah, it was tough. You know, it really was the fact that, you know, I don't know, Dave would not think about it. Would it have changed the way you played as a player?
Right.
That's my biggest thing. And you know, look, I know Kyle Shanahan and I know him really well and all that. Them taking the football and everybody, it's a big deal. I would have kicked off. I would have at least give me that extra down on our offense against that defense.
Yep.
If we need to, we can use all four downs. They came in handy for Kansas City. But, you know, that's just me, and that's what I think most people felt. Kick off and determine where you're at and then go from there.
Yep.
But they decided, and he talked about it openly. Analytics says the third possession, you win. And so that's going to be up to debate for a long time. And it's not going to be favorable to the San Francisco 49ers, that's for sure.
Brock Purdy, 255 yards passing, touchdown pass, no interceptions. How do you think he handled, you know, the pressure cooker of a Super Bowl? How do you think he played?
I think he played okay plus, not great, good. You know, yeah, he didn't turn it over. I thought there were, you know, this is me being very critical and really focusing. I thought there's three or four plays that were put in and called to do a certain thing, and he didn't look at that guy sometimes. And that's where, oh man, I know. Like they had one play. I could be wrong, and I'm sure somebody knows more than me about this. Christian McCaffrey got in a really funny formation in the backfield. And if I was on defense, I'd go, uh-oh, that's different. So they set it up and they did it. And a couple of plays later, they did it again and they got what they wanted. And I forgot which linebacker he was against. He went out and gave him a little quick move running right at him. And I think it's going to be a huge play. But Brock Purdy did complete the pass to an in cut. I forgot who that was to. Trying to think. It could have been, well, it doesn't matter who it was, the receiver too. But there were a couple of plays like that.
Right.
A long one down the field that was broke up by Legarius Sneed. You know, if he just got rid of the football in time, I think it's going to be a touchdown. And then, unfortunately, your man, remember Chris Jones, planted his helmet right in Brock Purdy's chest, and Brock Purdy missed Deebo Samuel down the sideline for a touchdown too. So that's just a couple that come to my mind. And, of course, you talked about it to start the show. Unblocked Chris Jones, two guys wide open for a touchdown and not able to throw the ball because – a damn Chris Jones, you know more than me because you had to block guys like this, but he seems to get more athletic as time goes on. He's really I think that goes, he's so mobile and so limber. I mean, he's like a, I don't know what to say. I'm trying to make say a word that is, describes it and doesn't make people mad. He's like Gumby or something. I don't know. You know, he's just limber as hell, and he uses it, and he's just a great athlete.
That's exactly what I was going to say, Phil. He's Gumby that can bench 500. It's like, what the hell? What do you do with that? I mean, you know, it's like, come on, man. It's like he is so powerful, so explosive. It's like, man, do I set strong for him? Okay, he'll quit me. Do I set soft? Oh, man, here he comes in the bowl. And he has a good feel for, you know, reading the guy's weight distribution, all that sort of thing, man. I mean, he is a problem. That's why I couldn't believe that, in my mind, if I'm an offensive line coach, I make sure that I'm putting two bodies in that dude, man.
Yeah, you know, and since you're right, and I kind of go on this too. You want to double team him. You want to use your back every now and then to help out, stuff like that. And you know, I say this as a tremendous compliment. Chris Jones knows when to turn it on.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like he's – and look, he's there. He's not going to go all out sometimes, and you know, I don't think. Uh-huh. But when the moment's big, look out.
Yeah.
And he proved it, you know, he proves it all during playoffs, every game, and he just knows when to turn it on. And, man, he's one of the top defensive players in the NFL. We don't talk about that enough, but, man, he deserves a lot of credit. And he's a big guy that can go inside or outside.
He's a freak. He really is. I mean, a free agent. You got to figure – I mean, Kansas City's going to try to figure something out, but, I mean, it is crazy.
Dave, would you go to another team if you're Chris Jones? I just can't imagine.
Not if it's even within the neighborhood.
Yeah. I mean, if I'm another team, I wouldn't even make a bid because you're not going to get him because they're going to find a way to keep him. He's a cornerstone of that team, just like Mahomes and Kelsey and whoever else you want to pick out. You take Chris Jones off that team, they're not going to win the Super Bowl.
Agreed. You know, so. Agreed. Yeah. Absolutely agreed. So quarterback play overall in the National Football League, Phil, last year. I know you haven't had time to review everything and every game and all that, but during the course of the season, what was your – and as the season concluded in the Super Bowl and everything, what was your overall opinion of quarterback play in the National Football League in 2023 and 2024?
You know, listen, if a couple guys like Joe Burrow, if they stay healthy and all that, I mean, I think quarterback play is ridiculous. It's off the charts good. I mean, we just – take for granted. I know the game has changed tremendously. I'm watching young quarterbacks now in college, and I'm actually grading them – or not grading them. I don't do that. But looking at more of the short passing game than I am the downfield because the NFL, it's pick, 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 then go for the shot. And that's what the league has turned into, and you got to be a machine throwing the routine throws. You just can't miss any of them. But the offenses have gotten better. But I think overall quarterback talent, the play, and – whatever else you want to say, it's the best I've ever seen in the NFL. And it all comes down to this, too. I don't care how talented you are. You need help.
Yep.
We need the coordinator. We need the play calls, the play designs, and we need people around us. That's to judge it any other way, you know, I didn't expect a Bryce Young to be the best quarterback or have a great year at Carolina. I mean, I knew where they were at. And I didn't expect CJ Stroud to be so damn good. Did you see him in the NBA celebrity game?
Yeah.
Wow.
Dude can ball, man. I mean, he's an athlete.
Hey, you know, and I didn't see this at Ohio State, but it didn't deter me what I thought about him. I thought greatly of him. I thought he was the best quarterback coming out last year. But, man, he showed athletic ability with Houston that I didn't really recognize. It was so clever and quick. And then when I saw the All-Star game, I go, now it really makes sense. He can just – he's that guy. He's Joe Burrow.
He is. He's a hell of a baseball player, too. A three-sport guy like Joe. You're right. Joe Burrow, same thing in high school. Dominated, you know, all three sports. It is crazy.
Quarterback. You know, I just give you a little thing. I won't tell you the names. There was a quarterback.
Phil Sims, too, by the way. High school stud. Multiple sport high school stud, Phil Sims.
Well, yeah, back then, you know, that was a different thing. So it was great. But – a coordinator, there was a draft coming up, and they had this guy they were going to take in the first round. They ended up taking him in the first round. I don't want to say his name.
Yeah.
But they went around the table. First round. Everybody knew, we got to take him first round. They come to the coordinator, and he goes, I don't even want him as a free agent. And everybody's like, what? And he goes, listen, he was terrible at basketball. He makes only a few good throws a game. He can't play golf. And he just went on and on. He goes, what quarterback can't do these things? And he was right. The guy was a first-round pick, and he was awful. He just had no chance. But that is kind of true. I mean, I played golf when I was playing with all the quarterbacks. I mean, hell, everybody was hitting the ball out of sight. That's what it was. And you just can play. You can shoot. You're the shortstop on the baseball team. Oh, you want me to pitch, coach? I'll be the catcher. That's yep. What, you know, there was a time when you were playing, probably I'd say 90% of the quarterbacks in the league were baseball, football, even basketball players.
Right on. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Everybody was. You're right. Yeah. And it was encouraged back then. Instead of, specialization, it was like, go improve your skill set. Do as many things athletically as you possibly can. Make yourself better. I mean, it's changed so dramatically that way. Man.
Yeah, it has. And it's, look, playing multiple sports, whatever. Baseball was our big thing in my family. And I loved it. I didn't like baseball. I loved it. And, man, I couldn't wait for baseball season every year. Yeah. I know it was in Louisville, Kentucky. The only thing that was bad about high school baseball, man, we played a lot of cold games. Wind, cold, spitting rain. It was awful.
I hear you.
You know the feeling.
Okay, so everybody's looking for the quarterback. College football, you know, people are saying, oh, there's five, six quarterbacks going to be in the first round. And I know it's in the early stages, and I know you're in the process of evaluating these guys and studying tape. What do you think about the quarterback crop this year? And is it overblown to say, oh, a half dozen guys will be first round draft picks?
I would be very surprised if a half dozen went in the first round.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of quality. I think we're looking at, I won't get into the names really yet, but we'll just say JJ McCarthy. I watched him play and they're on TV all the time. And that I went, okay, he's still raw. He needs another year, but I understand why he came out. It's hot. It's a good time for him to come out. They win the national championship game. Michigan, I don't know how many guys are going to lose. I've heard they could have like three quarters of the team can be drafted. But just watching him, I was like, oh boy, I was watching this morning and I go, ooh, this is better than I expected. Really good arm. And he only has one speed, and that's fastball down the middle. Every throw, he throws screen passes. I'm telling you, he smokes them out there. So, but that's kind of a good example. As I watch it, I just go, oh, he's caught me off guard. He's raw, but I can see starter NFL talent without question. But is that right away? And the answer there would be, for me, there's just no way he would be the first round pick and be the starter right away. I just don't see that. He needs more throws. That's these college teams. Joe Burrow, he's at, down there at LSU. Look at all the throws, all the experience, and that translated really fast to the NFL.
Right.
So that would just be one. I would see JJ McCarthy, maybe if somebody had a second, two first rounders late in the first round, or move up somewhere taking him. But realistically, I would just guess right now it's early. Second round, and I think there's going to be a pretty good crop there where you can get a guy one day that can be the starter, but he has no chance of being starter day one, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
And, I see that, with what else are you going to push on TV? If you're ESPN, the NFL Network and all that, quarterback, 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 quarterback.
Sure.
Who's going where? Justin Fields is going here. This is so. It brings more attention to the game and to the draft and everything that's involved, because hyping the quarterbacks is what people want to hear.
Trades are so hard to get done. I mean, it takes two to tango. We all know that. Do you think that potentially one of these trade for quarterback possibilities may come to fruition? And if so, do you have a feel for which one might be?
Well, I think it's a given. Justin Fields will not be back to Chicago now. I mean, he took him, what, Instagram? Is that what it was on? I don't know. Whatever. I got to get into this. I actually been watching Instagram for the last week. I've never done it in my life. And I'm going, yeah, this is addicting. guys doing whatever. It's everything.
Yep.
But, Justin Fields is going to move. The question is where.
Yeah.
And then there's always talk that somebody can move out. That's the big talk. New England's got the third pick. Will they take a quarterback or move out? All that. And, you know, I believe this. I listen to a lot of smart football people and coaches, and they all say the same thing, but I think it's – I understand it, but it's not reality now. You need to build the team inside out, and then we get the quarterback. Well, by the time you build it inside out and your quarterback's not the guy or whatever, you're fired. you know that. Now, so you got to go out there and get the quarterback, even though your team is not ready to support him, but we got to do it. Yeah. And if you – what it does, the offensive coordinator and the head coach, they got to be creative and understand the positions they're in. And some of these guys will be ready to be starters first day, but to really help them out with all that. And one thing I see in college football, and I say it every year probably, there's a lot of bad offensive designs out there, Dave, a lot. As I look at it, and I go, wow, this – I've even written it down twice already. This offense is awful. It has no correlation to NFL football, but I do like the quarterback's talent a lot.
Yeah.
So it's not what we think. There's the creativity in college football, and I understand lack of time, young kids, all that. But man, just helping the quarterback out, it's just like it's just not enough. That's for sure.
You've hit on a thing that I think is so vitally important. Not the quarterback position, obviously first and foremost, but other guys. If you get stuck with a coach that has got a horrible system and he's not a very good coach, but you're a pretty good talent, it can really hurt you. I mean, there's no question about it. And that to me is the biggest thing in trying to identify who's draft worthy at what round and everything. Because, I mean, man, if you're fortunate enough to be in the right environment, it's like, you know what? Maybe the environment has elevated this guy's talent level, and this poor guy is in a crap hole, and he's pretty damn good. And figuring that out is the toughest thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And it's just this way. And, you know, this is how I do it. And I, you know, nobody else, I'm sure they go, well, Phil's wrong, and I don't care. Say it. I'm not worried about that. I'm really looking forward to telling the truth, what I see. And I'm going to really put the work in because I don't want to do a disservice to any of the players.
Yeah.
But so true. I judge the quarterback. I'm looking at him and the circumstances he's under. I can honestly tell you this. I don't know and won't look at their numbers, their touchdown interception ratio. None of that completion percentage. I don't even care what the record of the team is. I just don't do it. I watch games after I kind of study them. I'll watch a few games to see the rhythm of the game and see what, you know, get the feel that way. But the rest of it, you said it all. Give me some average talent and a badly designed offense, and I'm telling you what, you can take any good quarterback. We can take Patrick Mahomes and make it look pretty ordinary. So look, I'll give you one good example right there in Cincinnati. Look at Joe Burrow's offense at LSU his junior year. I liked him a lot. I said, man, this offense it's day one installation even in college.
Right.
And look what happens when they open it up. Then his talent, hell, even I was so shocked. I was like, damn, his talent's much more than I thought it was. And right. I think that's still true in today's game with these college kids too. So you got to be careful how you judge it. And don't just do it on numbers, their stats. Oh, when he throws deep crossers, he's 87%. Okay, I don't know. So that's just the way I do it. And I like it. And until it proves me dramatically wrong with a bunch of them, then I won't change.
And people are very interested in your perspective and what you have to say about it. There's no question about it. Phil Sims.
Yeah, I'm like you. I'm learning. I'm going to do a podcast. You know, I'm doing a podcast with my young son. And, you know, we were talking a little this morning. I said, yeah, man, I know you got a big mouth, son. So I know you'll tell the truth. But I'm looking forward to really just giving my opinion. This will be the first time I'm going to probably – you know, I don't want to get into that, oh, who's number one, their rating, where they go in the draft. I'm really looking forward to doing this with all the positions, but more with the quarterbacks than any other one. And just trying to tell the truth and analyze it as good as I can.
Is it too early? Have you gotten into looking at other guy like Bowers, the tight end?
No.
Jordan? Okay.
No, I tried to take last week off because of the Vegas, the season.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be honest too, man, if I had to watch any more film of NFL football, It's gotcha. You know what I mean? Yeah, hey, here. Days I sit there and go, oh, I don't know if I can. Let me get up.
Your eyeballs turn into lenses, man. It's like, what?
It's amazing. It is. But that's the season. And, you know, it's like playing. You don't realize how exhausted you are, right? When you were playing until the year was over and you went, oh my God.
Yeah.
I'm out. And it's so recovering, even doing this job we do. It's a big thing for me, and I'm rested up. I'm ready to go, and it's a new challenge with college football. That's for sure.
No doubt. Dave Lapham here, and every day I am grateful for my experience to have played professional football. As a player, I realize self-motivation, leadership, and appreciating your teammates are key. At First Star Logistics, you can use those same attributes to create the life you want for you and your family. Build your future by working hard, like I did. You'll see results both on and off the field. Call First Star Logistics today and be part of our winning team. Opportunity knocking.